when I choose to go
all right.
gentlemen and ladies, we want to bring to you Memphis' own. The world's been waiting on it, and now the wait is finally over. Chantel.
Trouble in my way, I have to cry sometimes.
is what we bring. A thousand hallelujahs, our offering.
A thousand hallelujahs.
Let all creation sing. God is
praised.
Praise the Lord, everybody. It's time for us to come share an experience. Come on, standing all over the sanctuary. Wherever you are, come join us today. As we go into our praise and worship, amen. Hallelujah.
Everybody say, come share. Everybody say,
lift your hands for just a moment and let the fruit of worship flow off your lips to the ears of God. Hallelujah. We serve a mighty God. He's holy. He's excellent. He's amazing. Everything that he does is amazing. And we thank him and we want to bless him on tonight. Hallelujah. Say, my God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Say, he can move mountains. Keep us in the valley. And he can hide us from the rain. Say, my God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken.
Strength when I've been weak.
Say, forever he shall reign. Come on, back to the top. Everybody, lift your voice. Say,
my God is awesome.
Come on, say, he can move mountains.
He can move.
Come on, say, keep us in the valley.
Keep me in the valley.
And he can shield and hide you from the rain.
Hide me from the rain.
Come on, say, my God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He heals me when I'm broken.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Strength when I'm weak.
Strength where I've been weak.
And forever he shall reign.
Forever he will reign.
Come on, let's tell him, my God is awesome.
God,
you can lift your voice and say it. Come on, help us say he's awesome.
Awesome.
Come on, we serve an awesome God today and forevermore.
Awesome.
Our God is awesome.
Awesome.
Say, my God is,
he's awesome.
Yes, he is, God's your you're awesome.
Awesome.
Yes, Lord, we praise you. And he's awesome.
Awesome.
Come on, say, he's awesome.
Awesome.
Come on, say, my God.
My God,
he's awesome. He's the Savior of the whole world. Say, he's the giver of salvation. It was by his stripes that we're healed. Come on, say, my God is awesome. Today, I am forgiven. It's by his grace that I'm living. So you want to praise his holy name? Come on, let's give it to him. Open your mouth and say, my God is awesome. Come on, declare it in this place that our God is awesome. Let the world know that we serve an awesome God.
Awesome.
Come on, Lord, you are awesome. Yes, God.
Awesome.
Come on, say, my God is awesome.
Awesome.
How many believe that we serve an awesome God today?
Awesome.
Lord, we declare that you're an awesome God.
Awesome.
Hallelujah, Lord, we declare it.
Awesome.
Come on, let's go down the line around. Hey, say, he's mighty.
He's mighty.
Come on, our God is mighty.
Mighty.
The Lord is mighty. Yes, Lord, you're mighty, and you're awesome.
Awesome.
Lift your voice and say, he's awesome.
Awesome.
Yes, Lord. Come on, say,
he's holy.
Our God is holy.
He's holy.
Yes, we serve a holy God, and he's awesome.
Awesome.
Come on, lift your voice and say, he's awesome.
Awesome.
Say, deliverer.
Deliverer.
He brought you out. He saw you through. And he's awesome.
Awesome.
Hey, Lord, you're awesome.
Awesome.
Say, protector.
Protect.
He shields us.
Protect.
He defends.
Protect.
He fights for us.
Protect.
And he's awesome.
Awesome.
Lift your voice and say, he's awesome.
Awesome.
Hey, he's been a provider.
Provide.
He looks out.
Provide.
He makes ways.
Provide.
He's a provider.
Provide.
And he's awesome.
Awesome.
Thank you, Lord, for being an awesome God.
Awesome.
Thank you, Jesus. He's holy.
He's holy.
He's holy.
He's holy.
He's holy.
He's holy.
And he's awesome.
Awesome.
Lift your voice and say he's awesome.
Awesome.
Come on, this last time, our God is awesome. Keep us in the valley. And he can hide you from the rain. Come on, say, our God is awesome. Say, heals me when I'm broken. He gives me strength when I'm weak. So you ought to praise his holy name. Now, if you got a praise for him, give it to him right here. You ought to lift the praise for a mighty and awesome God that we serve. He's holy. He's been a deliverer. He's been a keeper. He's been a provider. He's been a protector. He shields and defends. He fights for us. So you ought to bless his name. You ought to give his name glory. You ought to honor him in the temple. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, for we need his glory to enter into the sanctuary tonight. Come on, everybody, just clap your hands. Come on, let's give him glory. Hallelujah. Temple, glory, glory, glory to our King.
Glory, glory,
glory
to our King.
To the Lamb who was slain for my
being.
Come on, y'all can help us sing it. Glory, glory, glory to our King.
Glory, glory, glory to our King.
To the Lamb who was slain for my being. Here we go. Let's go. We cry glory. Come on, we cry glory to our King. Hey!
Sing a new song to our King.
To the Lamb who was slain for my
being.
Sing a new song.
For my being.
Come on, here we go.
We cry
to our King.
Hey,
say we cry
glory
to our King. Come on, I need everybody to lift your praise. Sing
hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Lord, you're worthy. Yes, you're worthy. Sing
hallelujah.
Lord, you're worthy. Yes, you're worthy. Sing
hallelujah.
Come on, say that. Hallelujah. That's the highest praise. Sing
hallelujah.
Our God is worthy of it. Yes, you're worthy, and you're worthy. Yes, you're worthy, and you're righteous. Yes, you're righteous. Yes, you're faithful. Yes, you're faithful, and you're holy. Yes, you're holy. Yes, you're holy. Yes, you're holy. And we love you. Yes, we love you. And we love you. And we love you, and we love you, hey. Yes, we love you, and you're holy, and you're righteous, and you're faithful, and you're faithful, and we love you, and you're holy, and you're righteous, yes, Lord, and you're faithful, and you're faithful, and you're faithful, and we love you, hey. Yes, we love you, and we love you. Yes, we love you, and we love you, and we love you. Yes, we love you, and we love you. We cry glory to our King. Crying, but give it to him. Don't just cry it, but give it to him. From the fruit of your lips, you ought to give him glory. From your lips to the ears of God, you ought to lift up a praise in the sanctuary. You ought to magnify the King. You ought to magnify the King. When you invite him in with your praise, you ought to give him glory. You ought to give him glory. He deserves it, and he's worthy. Hallelujah. Come on, clap those hands. Hey, you ought to give him glory tonight. Hey, it's a part of your destiny to give him glory. Say, say hallelujah. 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 Our God is worthy of it. Hallelujah. Hey, Lord, we love you. Yes, we love you. Lord, we love you. Yes, we love you. And you're holy. Yes, you're holy. And you're faithful. Yes, you're faithful. And you're righteous. Yes, you're righteous. And you're mighty.
Come on and sing it with us.
Yes, you're mighty. And you're holy. And you're faithful. And you're righteous. And you're faithful. And we love you. Yes, we love you. And we love you. Yes, we love you. And we love you.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, we love you. And we love you. Yes, we love you. We cry glory to our King. Hey! We cry glory to our King.
Come on and clap your hands and give God praise in this place. Come on and bless him like you know he's good. Come on, everybody. If you've got breath in your body, put those hands together and let's honor the greatest King ever, Jesus Christ our Lord. Come on and bless God for him on this evening. Amen. Be seated in the presence of the Lord. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. We honor God our Father, Jesus our Savior, the Holy Spirit our guide. It is a privilege to be in God's house one more time. Can you clap your hands and thank God for Jesus? Yeah. Why are you thanking God for Jesus? Appreciate God for the Holy Spirit. Awesome. Celebrate with me, my wife of 33 years, Pastor Patricia. Now do me a favor, let your neighbors know you're glad to see them on tonight. Will you turn and celebrate them? Come on, is that all you got for your neighbors? Come on, tell them it's good to see you. Just wave at them. Come on, wave at them. Wave at them. Come on, wave at them. Good to see you. Amen. To all of those who are watching at home, we honor and thank God for you. Amen. Being a part of what God is doing on this week. We are so excited about the idea of a purpose-driven revival, a revival that says, what is God doing? What is God saying? What is it that needs to happen in the kingdom and in the body of Christ? And we're thankful for that. Amen. Will you bless God with me for Bishop Jeff Davis on Wednesday night? Did a magnificent, amen, job at preaching. And then on last night, help me bless God for Apostle Sherman Allen. Amen. And will you thank God with me for this band and this praise team? Amen. Who have lend themselves to us for this week and all of our essential workers, our AV, our usher, security. We thank God for all of you. Amen. Being a part of what God is doing in this season. We've been talking about the idea of purpose, destiny, purpose, and destiny, the idea of purpose. Amen. What is God's purpose for my life? And purpose is really nothing that you ever reach, because you're constantly moving toward your purpose. The idea is that by the time you go to glory, you will have expended your purpose in the earth. And so as we look at purpose and we look at destiny, we look at the fact that you have to have a prayer life. You need to have the right perspective. Amen. And not only that, amen, but you got to have a praise. Amen. Unto the Lord. Amen. Amen. So we said that you got to have those things and you got to be caught up in them. Amen. Help me thank God for the man of God on tonight. Amen. Bless you. Amen. And last night we looked at purpose, that if it's going to be attained, at some point you must make the hard decision. And then not only that, but you must operate in a spirit of dedication to that which God has called you in. And then lastly, there must be a denial of self. There has to be a denial of self. Somebody say that with me, a denial of self. There has to be a denial of self. Tonight, as we extend and look into purpose just a little bit further, I'm going to grab and grasp from a great person who helps people to become, by the name of Stephen Covey, who deals with this idea of 7 habits of highly effective people. That means people who are going to make purpose, people who are going to fulfill destiny, they have these 7 habits. Now, before we get into them, he starts off by talking about the fact that when we are born, we are dependent. We are dependent. We need everybody to do everything for us when we are born. And then we move into an area called independent, where we don't really require anybody else. As a matter of fact, our receiving Christ is an independent act. It's not based upon our mother. It's not based upon our father. It's based upon our independent decision to come to Christ. The issue is that many people get stuck at the place of independence. But the greater place, he says, and the greater moral stance is a place that's called interdependent. When I'm dependent on you and you're dependent on me. And that's what Christ calls for in the body of Christ, that we will become interdependent. So as he talks about this idea of 7 habits, he says there are 7 things that people who are going to fulfill purpose, destiny, be successful, need to do. He says, number one, they need to be proactive. Somebody say proactive. Amen. They need to be proactive. When we look in the scripture, Paul deals with it in Philippians and chapter 3. He talks about this idea. He says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Listen to what he said. I press. I'm proactive. He says, I'm pressing. I'm moving toward the mark for the prize of the high calling. Amen. He says, I am proactive. I'm not waiting on somebody else. I'm forgetting what's behind me and I'm pressing. All right. So I got to be proactive. Somebody say proactive. Not only must I be proactive, but I also must begin with the end in mind. Somebody say begin with the end in mind. Mark chapter 8, verse 36 says it like this. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and then lose his soul? So I've got to begin with the end in mind. Where do I want to end up? I've got to begin with the end of mind. Somebody say begin with the end of mind. But then number 3, I've got to put first things first. I've got to put first things first. Where would that measure up in scripture, Bishop? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these other things shall be added unto you. I got to put first things first. I can't skip over God and expect to end up at my place of purpose. I've got to put first things first. So I've got to put first things first. Those are all independent qualities. And I told you, he said, we move to that. He said, but the greater is when we become interdependent upon each other. Now we move into that, because the 4th one in Stephen Covey's 7 habits of highly effective people is this: to think win-win. In other words, I'm not trying to beat somebody else. I want everybody involved to win. And when you're comfortable in your skin, you'll stop trying to be like everybody else and you'll just be the person that God has made you. Because here's the problem, and some of you have heard me say this before. Whenever I'm trying to be like somebody else, I will only be the second best them. Because I will never be able to beat them being them, because they are the authentic them. But when I come to myself and I understand who I am in God, I know can't nobody beat me being me. And I want you to notice I didn't say doing me, because sometimes doing me is a mess. But can't nobody beat me being me. What do you know how to do, Bishop? I know how to go to God. What do you know how to do, Bishop? I know how to repent and apologize. What do you know how to do, Bishop? I know how to walk in the authority that God has given me. But I've got to think when to win. Look what the scripture says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. He said, let nothing be done through strife and vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Did you know that was in the Bible? The Bible said if you're doing Christianity right, you esteem others better than you. That no matter how God bless you, you still esteem. That means that you honor other people. It don't take nothing away from you to tell somebody they look cute. It don't take nothing away from you to tell somebody they got an anointing. We esteem others. better. Why do you stand at the door, Bishop, and greet people on the way out having preached two services? Because that's how important people are to me. So we think win-win. Somebody say think win-win. And now we're into interdependency, which is the greater existence and moral character. It's not just about me, but I'm related and tied in with other people. So I think win-win. Now here's number five. Hold on to your seat. Here's number five. First, seek to understand and then to be understood. That's a hard one right there. At least for me, because my mind goes fast. Sometimes when people are thinking, I'm already thinking what I'm going to say. I'm almost listening. Anybody ever almost listen? But if we're going to really be effective, we've got to first seek to understand and then to be understood. Now, this is in our scripture in the book of James, chapter 1, verse 19. It's declared, wherefore, my brethren, let every man be swift to hear and slow to speak. How many ears do I have? How many mouths? So I should listen twice as much as I talk. I'm talking about being able to walk in purpose and destiny. You got to seek to understand. To understand does not mean you're validating, even if it's a wrong behavior or a wrong topic, but you got to understand it. People get drunk for different reasons. You got to understand. People get high for different reasons. Are y'all listening? People step out of their marriages for different reasons. Are y'all listening? People sleep around for different reasons. You got to seek to understand and then to be understood. Did I lose y'all? So that's what you got to do. Now we're in interdependency. Here's number six. Number six, what I've got to do is I've got to learn how to synergize. You know what synergy means? Synergy means it's not my way, it's not your way, it's our way. And you know the biggest reason why ministries in the church can't get work done? Because people don't synergize. It's my way or the highway. People do not synergize. Why would you get mad over what color the balloon gonna be? When you need to be praying that God fill the church with enough people to see the balloon. So I've got to synergize. Now the Bible shows me this in the book of Amos, chapter 3. It says in verse 3, can two walk together except they be agreed? If we're going to walk together, if we're going to walk in purpose, because me getting my purpose out is dependent on you, and you getting your purpose out is dependent on me. God doesn't have superstars, he only has servants. They begin with the same letter, amen, but they mean two very different things. And so I've got to be able to synergize to work together. But then this last one, he says, after I've done that, after I've been proactive and after I've began with the end in the mind, and after I've kept first things first, after I've gone with a win-win attitude, after I've thought about the fact that I want to hear before I speak, after I synergize, he said, then the last thing I got to do is sharpen my saw. And what that means is because I've been working in my life, sometimes my life needs a retuning. And I've got to sharpen my saw. I've got to spend time in my word. I got to spend time before God. I got to spend time in the presence of God so that I can sharpen my saw. It's not anyone else's responsibility to have the thought of sharpening me, but it is their responsibility to be involved in the process. Can't nobody make you read your word. Can't nobody make you pray. I can't make you pray. I can't make you live saved. I can tell you what the word says. But everyone has got to sharpen his saw. And where do we find the best example of that? In the word of God, 2 Timothy chapter 3, 16 and 17. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine and reproof and correction and instruction in righteousness. Listen what he says, that the man of God or woman of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all hell raising, attitude problems, good works. Watch this now. That means if I'm really saved and doing it right and I really understand my purpose, there ought to be some work behind it. So God says he has purposed you. And if he's purposed you and you sharpen your saw, your purpose will be unto good works. That's what your purpose will be. We don't work to be saved, but we work because we are saved. And so as we yield to God in this season, and we're talking about purpose-driven revival, we're saying, God, I want to be effective. I don't want to be empty. I want to be effective. I don't want to be a gas tank that's empty, or I don't want to be a ice tray that has no ice in it. I don't want to be a refrigerator that's hot. I want to be on target. Is there anybody in there tonight who could say, God's been good enough to me that I can be on target for him? Is there anybody in here who knows your best days at getting God the best out of you have only just begun? Is there anybody in here who can say, I know that I'm blessed and highly favored, and as much as God has given back to me, I can render service unto him? Is there anybody saying, I'm getting everything that God has for me? From the head to the toe, I'm blessed going out, coming in, lying down, rising up. The greater me has just shown up. Tell somebody that the greater me has just shown up. They're getting ready to sing. Can you clap your hands and give God praise for the fact that you have purpose? If you can live through the problem, you can live through the blessing. Amen. If I were you, I wouldn't die for nothing right now. I tell the devil, you need to get the hell up out of here, because I'm not even about. Given everything that I went through, all things got to work together for good. So being that I've been through hell and high water, God's got to be getting ready to do something to blow my mind. Somebody say, blow my mind, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. I was getting ready to say blessed and highly favored, Scott, but what I heard in my spirit was rich and highly favored. That's what I heard. Somebody here need a breakthrough. They're getting ready to sing. Hallelujah. They're getting ready to sing. Be seated in the presence of the Lord. The man of God is going to minister the word. Hold on to what I said. You got purpose. Somebody say, I got purpose. Somebody say, I got purpose. Say it again, I got purpose. If you don't mind, I don't want to bother you, but reach in your purse or get your phone, put the mirror on it, look in there and tell yourself, say, I got purpose. Everything that the devil meant to destroy me with has built me up to walk in my purpose. Destiny is my name. Purpose is my claim to fame. I'm walking in purpose. I'm rich and highly favored. Rich with joy. Rich with peace. Rich with love. Did you get it? Look at yourself. If you ain't got it here, just look at your hands. Come on and say, I'm blessed. And I got destiny. And I got purpose. Come on, say, the bless me just showed up. Get ready, enemies. Get ready, devil. Get ready, imps, because the best is yet to come. Clap your hands and give God praise. Aroma. Come on, how many know we serve a holy God? Come on, clap your hands.
Put your hands together, say. Come on, put your hands together, say. Come on, put your hands together, say.
One more time.
Come on and clap, yeah. Come on and put your hands together, say. Come on and put your hands together, say. Come on and put your hands together, say.
We will exalt. For you are holy, holy, holy.
Then my blessing will.
Power, power, when the praise is.
hands and bless God. My God, my God. I tell you, it feels like Sunday morning church in here tonight. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor, I want a Sunday morning breakthrough. How thankful we are to be in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Again, we thank God for all of those of you who are watching at home here in the city and those who are watching in different states. We appreciate and thank God for all of you. Amen. For tuning in. We are in unusual times, but we serve an unusual God who is able to do unusual things. And so we don't complain. Amen. We just celebrate. Amen. The fact that we're on the right team. Amen. We're on the right team. I don't care what happens. I promise you this. God ain't going to come down with COVID. I can promise you that. Amen. He's always. Amen. Hallelujah. I feel that anointing in here. My God. Somebody just holler breakthrough. Listen, it's giving time. Come on, it's giving time. Praise God. It's giving time. Amen. This is our first virtual revival, our first pandemic revival. Amen. And again, I want to thank all of you. I want us tonight, amen, to step out, amen, in faith, those of you who will. I need at least 50 people who will sow a seed of $50 on tonight, a $50 seed. And if you, it's because I kind of want to know where I'm at. I know some of you are at home. Amen. And I want you to stand with us also, those of you who are at home. Amen. If you're in this sanctuary and you're going to sow that seed, I want you to pop up on your feet real quick. Amen. I'm going to sow it. I love y'all so much. I promise you I do. Amen. Even the man of God is giving tonight. Come on, praise God. Amen. Sowing a seed. Amen. A $50 seed on tonight. Amen. Bless you all. Amen. Praise team. Amen. One or two more people. Amen. Those of you at home, I need your support. Amen. The church needs your support. Amen. This revival, I really didn't budget it because I knew God said that it needed to be done. So there was really no arguing or trying to figure out anything. But I believe you can help us to end up on top. Amen. Thank you all. Amen. So much. I appreciate y'all. Boy, this is a great church. I don't care what anybody says. Amen. Those of you at home, amen, get your gift, get your seed ready. Let's make ready to give on tonight. Amen. Let's make ready to give. $50 seed. There are a number of ways you can give. Amen. You can give $ GNBC 8237. Amen. Also, you can go on our text tithing. Amen. And you can give that way also. Amen. And I believe that information will continue to go across the screen. Amen. As we prepare to give. Amen. On tonight, we do want to give a shout out to our service pastor. I talked to him right before getting here on tonight. Amen. He is working, amen, out of state right now. And we just want you to know that we miss you, service pastor. Amen. We really do. Amen. Pastor Chris Turner. Amen. Praise the Lord. Get your gift ready. Let's hold it up on tonight. And repeat after me, as we give today's tithe and offering, we're believing God for jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, business prosperity, sales and commissions, settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and incomes, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, better yet, checks in my hand, gifts and surprises, finding money, bills paid off, debts demolished, royalties received, money paid back, loans paid off. I shall lend and not borrow. I shall prosper and be in health. I shall give and be blessed. It's offering time, and I will, praise the Lord, I will give cheerfully in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Somebody shout, God is great. And somebody say, I'm debt free. Amen. That you may be seated as you give. If you're giving live giving, just hold your hand up and the deacons will serve you. Do. on, bless God for aroma again. Well, they sound like a thousand voices tonight. Sound like a thousand voices. Y'all, they've worked all week. Come on, give God a hand of praise for them. Amen. What would you do if I told you it's preaching time? We have a man of God who not only can, but will, and is going to minister to us on tonight. I know that God has given him a word for this house. Come now and dine with me at the restaurant where God is the owner. Jesus Christ is the franchise before he paid the price on Calvary. The Holy Ghost is our chef. He has prepared our meal. And our server, who I've known for many years, amen, pastors the new Zion Temple Church of both Hammond and Indianapolis, Indiana. One church, two locations. Will you help me bless God for the one and the only Apostle Bishop Brandon Jacobs?
Come on, if you know God's will is what you want for your life, open your mouth and give him praise, because I want the will of God. Yee. Oh, come on, you can do better than that. I want the will of God. I want the will of God. Oh, yeah. That thing blessed me. You got to excuse me. I want the will of God. I know some of you all want to manipulate the will, but I found out that the safest place in the whole wide world is in God's will. Somebody just ought to go in and praise him, because you know I'm in his will. I'm in his will. Oh, come on, where my church at? I'm in his will. And he told me all things work together. Hallelujah! For the good of those who love him, and for those who are the called according to his purpose. I'm in his will. Yeah, I'm in his will. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm in his will. Hey, glory. Hey, go. Hey, Shaya. I'm sorry, that thing made me excited. I may not be in your will, but I'm in his. You may try to pull me down, but I'm in his will, and he's working it out. I dare somebody take 30 seconds and throw your head back and throw your hands up and shout, because I know I'm in his will. Yeah. Glory. I am so honored to be here today, and I thank God for this amazing man of God who, amen, I have watched and admired. Let me say this, and what a leader, what a leader, what a father, spiritually and physically, what a man of God. The text, when it talks about you have, you don't have many fathers, the word there for father is pater or pater. It's where we get our word pattern. What a pattern. What a footprint. He's a footprint. He's, when he steps, you step in his footprint. Then you take another step in. And if you keep following his footprint, yeah, it'll lead you somewhere. I'm trying to follow good footprints. Y'all ain't talking. And I tell them all the time when they call, y'all don't even got to ask this, Bishop, can I? Yes. What time? When? I'm honored every time you call me Bishop, and I honor you. I honor your anointing. I honor your example. I honor who you are in the earth, who you are in the kingdom. He is a gatekeeper to the Midwest. Come on. Not just Milwaukee, but the Midwest. I mean that. I'm not, if y'all watch me and know me, you know I don't go places and talk on this wise. But I've watched him since I was a kid in ministry, and watched his flow, and watched his leadership, and watched his integrity. Amen. And I thank God for just allowing me to be here, and that he will call me. It encourages me every time. Can we honor the woman of God that allows him to be the man of God? Come on, let's thank God for Lady Bert tonight. Oh, come on, y'all could do better than that. He is because of her. You better know it. I'm going to tell you now. We thank God for you. Amen. And can you clap your hands for yourself? It's just good to be in the house of the Lord. I'm going to tell you, the words of David are real in these times. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go. Anybody glad to be in the church tonight? Now, if you ain't glad to be here, you ought to leave so somebody who would be glad can come in. But if you're glad to be here, amen, we are grateful for, amen, what God is doing. With my hands lifted up, help me, and my mouth filled with praise. Won't you help me all over the room? With the heart of thanksgiving. Yes, sir. I will bless thee, O Lord. Come on, you gotta do it. All over the room, help me say, with my hands lifted up. Yes, Lord. And my mouth filled with praise. Yes, Lord. With the heart of thanksgiving. Oh, I will bless thee, oh Lord. Come on, one more time. This time you gotta do it with my hands lifted. Oh, yeah. And my mouth filled with your bande. Yes, Lord, with the heart, with the heart. I will bless thee, oh Lord. Come on now, I want you to help me. Come on, lift them hands. Let me hear you worship him. Come on. Come on. Yedamandosha. Come on, lift those hands and magnify him. Lift them hands and adore him. Yedamandosha. Lift them hands and give him glory. We honor your name, God. There's nobody like you. You are supreme. You are strong. You are mighty. You are our help. You are the lifter above our head. You are the reason we live. You are the reason we have our being. We honor your name. There is none like you nowhere. We can't find it, and we worship you. And we honor you. We break our back and bend our bow. We bow before you. For you are holy. Hallelujah. I will bless thee, O Lord. Come on, help me. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. Yes, I will. I will bless thee, O Lord. No shame. With the heart of thanksgiving. Oh, I will bless thee, O Lord. Come on, tell him, I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. Yeah, yeah.
I will bless thee, O Lord.
Oh, na-na-na-na-na-na, Mahosha. With the heart of, yes, I will. I will bless thee, O Lord. Ay, 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 ay. Thank you, Father, Joshua, yeah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy, his holy name. Yes, God. Yes, God. Hallelujah. Help me say, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Oh, my soul.
Oh, my soul.
And all.
And all.
That is.
That is within me. Bless it.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Lead. Is holy. Father, we thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for what you're getting ready to do even now. We pray that you, oh God, would speak to us. We thank you for your kabod, your weight of glory that's resting in this place. We thank you that our eye have not seen, our ear hasn't heard, neither has it entered the heart of man, the great things you're getting ready to do tonight. Spirit of the living God, shake, rattle, and roll this house. Let your word come alive like never before, that when we leave this place, it won't be said that we've seen Jacob's, but let it be said that we've seen Jesus. Let your word come alive in such a way that it shines a light on who you are, and we'll give you the praise, we'll give you the glory, we'll give you the honor. We thank you that cancer is drying up tonight. We thank you that diabetes is drying up tonight. We thank you that high blood pressure shall be leveled. We thank you that your glory shall rest in here. We thank you that revival is going to hit this house like never before. Lord, set us on fire, set us ablaze, push us to the next place in you, that when we leave this place, oh God, the glory will be upon us. Let the glory be on us like it was on Moses when he came from the mountain and his face shined in such a way that the people knew he had been with you. Lord, let your glory shine on us. We honor you, God, and we give you the glory for the victory. Fresh anointing now. Amanda, fresh anointing. Hey, glory, fresh anointing. Fresh anointing. Fresh anointing. Break it. That destroy yokes, that remove burdens, that changes minds, that saves souls. Higher. Let your glory be here, and we'll thank you for it, and we'll call it done. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. All those in agreement said, amen. Glory. There's an anointing in this house. Hey, higher. Oh, I dare you lift your hands. I dare you stretch them as high as you want God to pull you. Lift those hands. There's an anointing here. Hey, breka yande. Yanda mosha. Hey, hina na 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 na. Lord, we love you. We love you, God. I'll be your worshiper. 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 Yeah. I'll be your worshiper.
I'll be
your worshiper. I ain't going nowhere, Jesus.
I'll be your worshiper.
I'm gonna stay right here and worship you.
I'll be your worshiper.
Lord,
I'll be.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah. Zechariah chapter 4. Yeah. Zechariah chapter 4. Yeah. Don't you do that, Christian? We worship you, Jesus. There's power in my worship. We worship you, Jesus. There's power in my worship. We worship you, Jesus. Hiya. There's power in my
worship. We worship you, Jesus.
You're the most so tired.
There's power in your worship.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah.
We worship you, Jesus.
Zechariah chapter 4. I want to look at verse 6. I'm a worshiper, y'all. Come on, Christian, because I'd be laid out on this floor weeping and you know, So that's what got me through a pandemic. I built an altar in my house. I know some of you all only wait till you get to church to find an altar, but I knew how to be like Jacob and put a rock, and I laid my head on it until I knew that I was at the gate of heaven. Y'all ain't higher. And I worshiped until God delivered like never before. Out of 600 members, we had about now maybe up to 80 people who had the coronavirus, and probably about 15 of them was on life support and not a one left, because every time they told me that one was on the ventilator, I got on my face. And I said, Lord, who's going to praise you? If you tell me, I learned how to worship him until breakthrough came in. I learned how to worship him until deliverance took loose. I learned how to worship him until the angels walked in the room. And from that we birthed a CD during the pandemic. Did it in July. We released it on October 18th. And we have a song in there. I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord your healer. I sent my word and healed your disease. I am the Lord your healer. They've been playing it in the hospitals, and and people have been getting up healed. If David can play the harp until the king have peace, surely we can sing until the virus lift up off of people. Send my word and heal your disease. I am the Lord your healer. Zechariah chapter 4 verse 6. We're going to preach this word. I believe God, the anointing. I don't know what God getting ready to do up in here. But it's a heavy weight of glory in this house. Hey. God getting ready to shake. He getting ready to shake this place tonight. Zechariah chapter 4. Let's let God do what he does best. I'm just going to read verse 6. I'll deal with the chapter in its entirety. It's a very powerful passage of scripture I want to preach tonight. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6. It says, then he answered and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Can y'all read that with me? Come on. Verse 6. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6. Let's read it in unison. Ready? Let's go. Then he answered and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. I know you got your mask on and you are following the CDC rules and you're distant. But if you could yell through your mask across your neighbor and prophesy to them and say, neighbor, in this season, God is going to help you complete a hard thing. Find you another neighbor that's somewhere in your section.
and say, neighbor, don't be worried about what it looks like. Tell him, because in this season, God's going to help you complete a hard thing. Tell him, don't you be worried about it. Tell him, because he's getting ready to send you help. He will help you complete a hard thing. Yeah. Somebody receive the prophecy early and throw your head back and shout. Yeah. Oh, yes, he is. But by my spirit. Take your seat if you can. This prophetic corpus. Ooh, I like y'all. I like y'all. Is there anything? Is there anything too hard for God? The prophet Zechariah is one of the most, in my opinion, important prophets of the Old Testament. It is his prophetic words that are most quoted in the Gospels and the Apocalypse. That's how forward the prophet is. I know we often refer to the major prophet of Isaiah, but as you begin to read through the prophetic book of Zechariah, you will see how threaded he is in the words of Jesus, even how threaded he is even in the book of Revelations. He is such a prophet that many people won't even preach from the book, because there's some of the prophetic words that God gives him that we can have clear understanding of. Because you'll know that there are eight visions or eight visitations that God brings to Zechariah. And some of these visitations come with an angel that brings clarity. And then some visitations are left to the interpretations of those with a revelatory mind, or those who are steeped enough in scripture to bring clarity to the prophetic words that are given. I love this prophet because his name is very important to the book. He's the son of Birshaya, which teaches us or shows us how steeped he is in Levitical lineage. His grandfather and father were also Levites, or prophetic personalities in scripture. But I love his name because his name simply means the Lord remembers. This is very important because it is the prophet Jeremiah who prophesies that the children of Israel are going to be in bondage because of their sin. And then he tells them in the prophetic book of Jeremiah, he says, after 70 years of bondage, he says, the Lord will remember what he told you. And he's going to pull you out of bondage. 70 years down the line. There's another prophet who steps on the scene in the 70th year by the name of Zechariah. His name means the Lord remembers. Now that the 70 years are over, I come to speak a word that's going to get you out. Yeah, that's good news. There's a word that God can speak in your life that can shatter shatter and shake the shackles that are on your feet. Good God, here that you can speak one word and that one word will cause every chain to be broken. That one word will cause the bondage that's in your mind to have to fall off. The one word that God can speak in your life will shift you. But when you're carnal, you don't understand how important the word of the Lord is. That's why you can't go to sleep when the word is going on. That's why you can't stay at home, or better yet, turn off Facebook or turn off whatever means you use to tune in to service. You better put that service on surround sound and put it on every TV in your house. Let your children hear the word. Let your no good spouse hear the word. Let your enemies hear the word. Let the house hear the word. I just believe that the word is so strong that it'll make the electrical system work and the plumbing system work and, hallelujah, the HVAC system work. The word is so powerful that as God begins to speak it, it will cause things to come in order. If one word can cause dry bones to get flesh and then connect to the next bone and stand up and allow breath or life to get down in it, imagine what the word could do in your life. He, hallelujah, spoke the word. And I wish I had time, because I will almost walk you up here, because the first vision in Zechariah chapter 1 is very poignant and powerful, because that vision shows us a man of God who's on a red horse. He's on the red horse and he's astride the red horse. Behind him are other color horses. That it's a white horse and a brown horse. And here the man of God, which we would call in scripture a theophany, he's astride. He's not sitting on the horse, but he's astride the red horse. And I like what the text says. The text says he's astride the red horse in the ravine. The ravine is very important, because you will understand that there are valleys, but the ravine is the lowest place beyond the valley. Some folks thought that the valley was the lowest place, but really the lowest place you can go is the ravine. It's that place where alligators live and snakes live. It's the place where, if you're ever driving and you're driving in a low place, it's often that place on the highway where you look over and you can't see nothing down there. It's a low place. It's that place you don't want to get in an accident there and allow your car to roll over into the ravine. And the Bible says that here was a God or Jesus in the Old Testament riding on a red horse in the lowest place on the earth. And while he's in the low place, the Bible says he's looking. And I like what the text says, Bishop. It says he's riding in the low place amongst the myrtle trees. Who knew that trees grew in low places? Good God, here, that's another sermon for another time. He's riding in the low place and he's looking. And normally, anytime you see Jesus on a red horse, it normally means that he's coming to war. And when they see him on the red horse, seemingly the war, the children of Israel, when they hear the prophetic word, they get discouraged, because they've already been in bondage. So they don't know, is he coming to war against them, or what is he on the red horse for? But scripture or the prophetic word lets them know, I'm not coming to war against you, but the reason I'm on the red horse is because now your bondage has come to an end. And I'm not coming to war against you, but I'm coming to war against those who have put you in bondage. So the reason I'm riding in the low place is because I'm trying to look for those who are still in low places while I've set you free. Others have come out, but you're still in low places. Others have been set free, but you're still in low places. Others are walking in victory, but I thank God that I serve a God who loves me so much that he's not just the God of mountaintops, but he's even the God of low places. He'll ride on low places until he finds everybody that's still stuck. I don't know who I'm preaching to. He leaves that place. After that prophetic word, he has another vision. This time, the vision he has, the Bible talks about there are four horns, four ram horns that's coming from the four corners of the earth. And while they're coming from the four corners of the earth, they're coming to destroy Israel, who's in the middle. But watch the text, and I can't give y'all no more visions after this. Watch the text. The Bible says, as Israel is in the middle, and the four ram horns are coming to destroy them, the Bible says that the Lord sends four carpenters to fight four ram's horns. That don't make sense, do it? Since when did a carpenter show up to war? Normally, if I'm in a battle, don't send me no carpenter. I don't need no man with a hammer and screws while I'm in a fight. I need somebody with a gun, a knife, oh come on, a sword. I need somebody who's been, can you do karate? Can you kickbox? What can you do? Why in the world would the Lord send four carpenters to a battle? The reason God sends four carpenters to a battle is because he's trying to let Israel know that there's some battles I don't need you to fight. There's some battles all I need you to do is build. Oh God, hallelujah to God. See, because the best way you're gonna win in this season is not by fighting. The way you're gonna win in this season is by building. Y'all talking, but I'm building. You running my name in the mud, but I'm building. You trying to dog me out, but I'm building. What it says is, I'm not entertaining the crazy folk that got so much to say. I'm so busy building. And if I build, just keep. Look at somebody, tell them, neighbor, whatever you do in this season, just keep building. Oh, I dare somebody throw your head back and just holler, just keep building. Come on, somebody need to go home with that in your back pocket. Oh, come on here, I need you to holler. You're talking to yourself. You ain't talking to your neighbor. You ain't talking to your mom and them. You're talking to yourself. Throw your head back and holler, just keep building. So Zechariah is having vision after vision. He has several more. He has vision after vision. And this fifth vision starts off with the prophet being prepared to receive another discovery, for God to show him something else. The angel that talked with him, the angel is still talking to him. The angel that talked with him came and kind of shook him woke. It seems as if while Zechariah was getting these visions from the Lord, that the soothedness of the vision kind of put him to sleep. It's kind of like your children. You read them a bedtime story, and while they're having the bedtime story, it looks like the bedtime story kind of soothes them into a slumber. And here is Zechariah. My brothers and sisters, the text would teach us that he is heavy with sleep. Sleep has overcome him while he is understanding or seeing the visions of the Lord. But the Bible opens up in Zechariah chapter 4, verse 1, and the Bible says that the angel shook him as to say, you can't go to sleep right here, Zechariah, because what I'm getting ready to show you is very important to what the children of Israel need to see. The Bible says that the next vision that he shows him, there is an olive tree on the left, and there's an olive tree on the right, and there's a bowl in the air, and then there's a candelabra like what would be in the temple in the Old Testament. He don't seem to understand. There's a tree to the left, there's an olive tree to the right, there's a bowl in the air, and there's a candelabra, amen, at the bottom. The tree to the left and the tree to the right has like a plumb line or a hose that's connected to the olive trees to the left and the right, and then the Oh, just stick with me, because we're going somewhere. You better know it. And the bowl that's in the air that has the oil from the olive trees has a hose or a plumb line that is connected to the candelabra. It is the oil that's in the bowl that is putting oil in the candelabra. It is the oil that's in the candelabra that's allowing the candelabra to stay lit and bright. The Bible says that the angel looks at Zechariah and says, do you know or understand what these things be? Zechariah, thinking like a priest, I'm sure he began to think about the tabernacle, because you must understand there's the outer court, then there's the inner court, then there's the holy place, and in that place there's only one light that burns, and the light that burns in that place has oil in it. And the Bible says that God tells the priest, whatever you do, don't let the oil that's in the candelabra run out, because it's that oil that's going to keep the light lit and burn. But when he asked Zechariah, did he know what these things were? He said, no, my Lord, I don't know what these things are. The angel began to speak to him and tell him that the vision is concerning Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel is the offspring of Babylon. He was born while Israel was in exile. He's the grandson of King Jeconiah of Judah. He was the governor of Judah after the return from exile. And he is an ancestor, hallelujah, to Jesus Christ. He's a part of the Davidic line. Zerubbabel is most often identified, amen, as the son of Shealtiel, which was a great man of war during that time. They are a political family. They're a family of governmental lineage. As you look at this, my brothers and sisters, Zerubbabel is leading while Israel is coming out of bondage. And now that he's leading while Israel is coming out of bondage, he has found himself in a hard place. He has now laid the foundation. And the text would suggest, if you read it, that Zerubbabel had found himself in a hard place. He had found himself in a place where it seemed like he was fighting against a mountain that did not want to be moved. Have you been there? Where it looks like the Lord has told you to do something, and now what the Lord has told me to do, he's put me up against a mountain that can't seem to be moved. I'm in a hard place, a solid place, a firm place. Life is rigid. The prophet keeps telling me I'm anointed to make a difference, but every time I approach the difference, it's too hard for me to progress. Every time I get to the place where it looks like something new is getting ready to happen, it seems too hard, hallelujah, to progress. A hard place, solid, firm, rigid, not easily broken. You can't bend it, you can't pierce it. It takes a great deal of force. And some of you all are in here today and you're saying, I'm tired of fighting, I'm tired of always having to be the one in warfare, I'm tired of having to pray about the rough stuff. When am I going to have an easy season? When are things going to get easy for me? It looks like every time I turn around, God is blessing that person. She getting married after she didn't sleep with the whole community. Here he is opening up a business after he didn't sold drugs for the past 30 years. Look at this one getting a new car. And I know they don't pay their tithes because they told me. Look at this one over here getting a raise on the job. And here I am being faithful. I go to Bible study. I love my enemies. I give my offering to my leader. I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. Deacon Johnny was trying to sneak me to his house, and I said I wasn't coming over there because I want to be holy. Oh, y'all might as well say amen. And here I was trying to do the work of God, and every time that I turn around, it looks like I'm stuck between a rock and a hard place. Life is rigid. Life is
is hard. Life is rough. Life can't seem to get better. Everybody talking about how blessed they've been in a pandemic. But I was laid off. I lost my job. I couldn't make it through. And here I am trying to build. And I'm failing. Oh, but I got good news for you. My brothers and sisters, God is getting ready to help you do a hard thing. God is going to help you complete it. You ain't gonna just do it. There's some stuff, even though it's rough, God is getting ready to anoint you to complete it. Watch me now. This is the word. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, what you started, God has commanded you to finish it. Zerubbabel is trying to get back in the city. He's laid the foundation, but everybody's fighting against him. And the prophet comes to him and says, I don't care how hard it is. Finish it. I come to tell somebody, don't you let it be in rough make you stop. Don't you let it be in a fight make you stop. Don't you let it be hard make you stop. This is not the season to procrastinate or the season to start and then stop or to waver in the assignment. You laid the foundation. Now get up and complete the job. You started school. Now get yourself back up. Wipe the sleep out of your eyes and finish the degree. You started writing out the business plan and then got discouraged with how much it was going to cost you. Get your lazy self up and finish the plan. Oh God, my children, I got five. And out of the five children I got four boys. And they like to play a game called Mortal Kombat. And there's a certain process or a certain point in the game where they have almost won the fight. And while they're getting ready to win the fight, while the opponent is sitting there looking crazy, all of a sudden you hear a voice come across the screen. And the voice says, finish him. I don't know who I'm preaching to in here, but I come back to holler at somebody and tell you, whatever you do in this season, finish. Oh, come on. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, this is the season to finish. Zerubbabel was tired, discouraged, ready to throw in the towel. And the prophet basically said, I don't care. God has anointed you to finish it. Bishop, I'll never forget when Lady V was pregnant with Brandon Jr. He was the biggest baby we had ever had. We were in labor all night long. And my wife had gotten fatigued and tired and ready to quit. She was crying. And all the doctor kept saying was, this a big boy. And he was a big boy, over 10 pounds. And here she was. And that nurse said something to my wife that I couldn't say evidently myself. I was kind of scared, if you want me to be honest. I'm looking down there, looking at her, and looking down there, looking at her. I said, come on, baby. That nurse leaned in my wife's ear, and she said, Miss Jacobs, this is not my baby. It's yours. It's not in my stomach. It's in yours. I cannot push for you. Only you can push what's in you. She said, Miss Jacobs, we have been here long enough. I need you to lock your chin in your chest And I need you to do all you can to push your baby out. She said, because if you don't start pushing now, your baby is going to die. She said, but the reason you got to push so hard is because your beautiful baby boy is so big. But be a mama. That's what she told her. And she said, put your chin in your chest and push. Good God here. I don't know who I'm talking to, but my wife put her chin in that chest. She grabbed on to my hand until it looked like she was going to break it. And with tears rolling down her face, she... And that woman said, 1, 2, 3, 4. I see the head, Mrs. Jacob. She said, lift up and breathe. My wife breathed. She said, we're going again. We can't take long breaks. She said, put your chin in your chest and push while I count to 10. She put her chin in the chest and said, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And she said, come on, push. The shoulders are coming. And she said, once the shoulders get through, she said, the job is, I don't know who I'm preaching to in here, but I come back to tell you, what's in you is not my baby. It is your baby. And the reason it is hard is because it's so big. But you got to be willing to put the pushing in to get the baby out. He tells them, I'm going there, but I got to get it all out. He tells them, he says, don't be moved by your mountains. Just because God anoints your hands for the assignment doesn't mean it's going to be easy. This is not the season to be moved by the adversary that comes to hinder us. This is the season to go forth and to accomplish it. I come to prophesy to somebody and tell you that grace and favor are for the saints that's going to push anyway. Grace and favor are for the saints that's going to push anyway. Grace and favor are for the saints that's going to push anyway. Can we go back to the vision? The reason the prophet a breakthrough coming in this room now, I sense it. The reason the prophet had to tell Zerubbabel the vision, because as I told you before, normally in the temple, it takes the priest to put the oil in the lamp so that the oil can burn. But the interpretation of the vision is that God had put next to Zerubbabel two olive trees, not man, but two trees, and there was a hose that was connected to the tree, and the oil from the tree got in the bowl, and the oil from the bowl got in the candelabra, and the oil in the candelabra kept the bowl burning. Oh, you missed it. Let me give it to you again. Normally, there's a man in the temple who has to pour the oil in the bowl. And normally, the oil in the bowl drops in the candelabra so that the candelabra can light on fire. But in the vision, there's two trees. The hose is connected to the trees. The oil comes from the trees. The oil gets in the bowl. The oil in the bowl drops in the candelabra. And the candelabra keeps on burning. You still missed it. I'm going to give it to you again. Normally, there's a man. And the man comes and puts the oil in the bowl. And the oil drips from the fire in the bowl to the candelabra. And it keeps the candelabra burning. But in the vision, there's no man. I come back to tell you, God is getting ready to Do you hear me? I don't need man in this season, but God, he's getting ready to put a tree on the left, put a tree on the right, and God is going to give you everlasting resources to make it in this season. Lord, I wish you can grab your neighbor's hand, but since you can't grab it, because we're in the COVID season, do me a favor, do me a favor, do me a favor, 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 and say, man, God's gonna be your source. Y'all don't want to have no church. I said, look at your neighbor and tell him, neighbor, God will make a way for you. He's gonna provide like you ain't never seen. I stopped by to tell you that eyes have not seen them, and ears haven't heard them, what God, he's getting ready to do in your life. He's moving man out the way, and he wants you to know that in this season, you ain't gonna win, because people were there. In this season, you ain't gonna win, because friends were there. But God wants you to know that what he gonna do for you, it's not by power, it's not by might, but it's by my spirit, saith the Lord. God, he's getting ready to cause his spirit to be your advancement. His spirit is getting ready to push you. His spirit is getting ready to help you. His spirit is getting ready to pull you through. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but I stopped by to tell you to be encouraged. You got to be like David and encourage yourself, because God is pushing you. He's pushing you. He's pushing you. He's pushing you. Working on my outside, and what a change he's made in me. If you know we're pushing you in your section, just go to pushing, just go to pushing. Start walking in your push, start walking in your anointing. Start walking in your power. Start walking in your new level, because there's an anointing that's on you to press. There's an anointing that's on you to press. Press toward the mark for the prize of the higher calling, which is in Christ Jesus. Don't be worried. Worried about what your enemy said. Don't be worried about those who are fighting you. But I hear in my spirit to set your affections, to set your affections, to set your affections, to set your affections, to set your affections on things above and not on things beneath. I ain't looking at y'all, but I'm looking to the hills from which coming my help. Cause my help coming from God. Look at your neighbor and tell him, neighbor, don't look at me, but tell him, look up. Tell him, look up. Tell him, look up. Tell him, look up. Thank you. Look up, cause up above my head, I see a cloud, I see a cloud, I see a cloud. The size of a man's hand, and it's getting ready to rain. If you know it's gonna rain, wave your hand, open your mouth, and tell God, I'm ready for the rain. You sown in tears, you gonna reap in joy, cause it's raining time. What you suffered in the flesh, you get ready to reap it, cause it's raining time. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory which shall be revealed. And when he you won't be able to give man glory, cause man can't get the glory. Man can't get the glory. Man can't get the glory for what God is getting ready to do. Won't God do it? I said, won't God do it? I said, won't God do it? Anybody know God? Anybody know God will? Anybody know God will? Anybody know God will? Anybody know God will? Say, yeah! Won't he do it? You shall finish a hard thing. Prophesy to somebody. Prophesy to somebody. Tell them you shall finish a hard thing. Go back to school. Open the business. Get your home together. Invest your money. It's hard, but the anointing is in this room to help you do. Wave your hand, open your mouth, give God a shout, cause you've been anointed, you've been anointed, you've been anointed. Now, in all of these things, you are more than conquerors. You are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ, which loves you. Open your mouth and shout. I need somebody to open their mouth and shout right here, like you know the anointing is in this place. Oh! We as saints get it twisted. We think that just because we have faith, it's supposed to be easy. We think just because we sowed the seed, it's supposed to be easy.
We think that just because God told us to do it, it's going to be easy. It was your God who told the disciples to get on the boat and to go to the other side. And then the storm came. No. But you got to know, if God told me to do it, He's going to help me to finish. I like it. Look at somebody close to you and say, hey, you will finish it. Oh, come on. Look, I need you to get real hood with them and look at it and say, don't play with me. Don't play with me. Come on, tell her, I don't care nothing about how sick you are. I don't care nothing about what you're going through in your body. I don't care nothing about how much money you say you have. I don't care about your haters. We beyond the hater season. We all got haters. Who cares? There ain't nobody worried about no haters. I'm tired of hearing about everybody hating on you. And this one don't like you. And this one ain't got your back. Away with that foolishness. Don't nobody care. You got haters. I got haters. We all got haters. Haters come with the territory. So let's quit talking about haters and let's focus. Come on, look at him. Come on, look at him and say, I don't care what it looks like. I don't care how weak you may seem. I don't care about the folk who dogging you out. Tell them, I come to prophesy to you. And I come to tell you to finish it. And finish it now. Tell them, come here, God, I feel the breakthrough coming. Tell them, if you don't finish it in this season, you may not get another season to do it. So I need you to yell at them and tell them, finish it. Because God's going to help you complete a hard thing. Oh God, somebody who knows He's going to do it. I need you to open your mouth and praise God like you already got it in your hand. I need you to praise God like you already got it in your bank account. I need you to praise God like you already living in it. I need you to praise God like you already driving in it. I need you to praise God you walking across the stage with a degree in your hand. I need you to praise God like your credit is a 900. Come on, chop. You better praise Him, brother. You better praise Him, brother. I like it when the men lead in praise. You better praise Him, brother. I need somebody who ain't worried about no music to go to praising God right now like you already got it, like it's in your hands, like it's in your possession, like you already have it, like it's in your wallet, it's in your bank account, it's on your feet, it's on your back. You see God doing it. He's anointing me while I'm praising.
Come on.
praise him. Hallelujah. Your praise is getting better to make it easier. It's gonna get easier. Yonder the bush. It's gonna get easier.
We prophesied to our church in the craziest season that all the credit scores that were going down, that God was getting ready to cause them go up, up, up. And do you know that by the end of the week, we start getting testimonies about credit scores going up? There's some things during this pandemic that went down. Besides credit, money went down. Things just wasn't right. But I prophesy, everything going down is going up, up, up. And this is what we tell them in our church. We said, listen, everything going down is going up. You. Those of you who know God has released the anointing to do a hard thing, I want to challenge you. And watch this. Y'all remember that? Favor, favor is all.
That's how I'm going to finish. That's how I'm starting a business in a pandemic. That's how my credit going up in a pandemic. That's how I'm buying houses, finishing school, getting to the next place. Hi, because I got something on me you ain't got. Look at somebody, tell them, hey. You better praise him, brother. You better praise him, brother. You better praise him, brother. Hey, yonder bush. One thing, and I want to challenge you. One thing that's shifting in this pandemic is the leadership of men. Men are getting ready to embrace their rightful place. And they're getting ready to lead in everything. I prophesy that men are stepping back up in the face of God. Men are learning in the pandemic that the only way you make it when he shut up heaven and there be no rain and pestilence come on the earth is if my people, Yadabosh, which are called by my name, humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Men are learning that no matter how much money you have, you still need God. And I just need about 70% of the men in here on this next praise to go to praise, because I prophesy as you praise him, your house getting ready to shift, your money getting ready to shift, your mortgage getting ready to shift. I dare you, men, leap if you got to, run if you must, dance if you will. But I need some men. Help me praise him, Scott. Praise him for the men. Praise him, God. Help me. Help. Praise him, bro. That's what I'm talking about. Because your praise is shifting it. The spirit of David is getting ready to come on to me. And my house gonna shift. I'm gonna be a better husband. I'm gonna be
Oh!
Listen. God is going to help me complete a hard thing. Somebody clap. He got 30 more seconds. See, that's a, see, they can't do that kind of stuff to me. See, when you do that kind of stuff, that, I don't want no music, I just want claps. Praise him for the baby. Give me that track, Christian. Come on, give it to me. If you don't praise him, these rocks will cry out. If you don't praise him, these rocks will cry out. If you don't praise him, these rocks will cry out. If you don't praise him, these rocks will cry out. If you don't praise him, these rocks, hey,
will cry out.
If you don't praise him, these rocks
will cry out.
We don't need no music. We got the Holy Ghost. We don't need no music. We got the Holy Ghost. We don't need no music. We got the Holy Ghost. We got the Holy Ghost.
We got the Holy Ghost.
We got the Holy Ghost.
We got the Holy Ghost.
We got the Holy Ghost.
We got the Holy Ghost.
We got the Holy Ghost.
We got the Holy Ghost.
I told y'all that the anointing was going to hit this house today. Praise him, baby. I love it when the babies praise him like that. That's how I got filled with the Holy Ghost. Praise him, baby. Take me 1984. Give me country church, Christian. 1984, come on. That is, come on. I want old school church. Praise him, baby. She then came down. Praise him, baby. Because guess what? Our children coming back to God too. I'm telling y'all, this pandemic shifted the church in the right direction. Your grandchildren. And they're not coming in like you think they are. Some of them gonna come in with the Holy Ghost already. Because God gonna get some of them while they're out on the corner. Trying to do wrong. You better hear what I tell you. Some of them gonna get it in the shower. Some of them gonna be rolling a blunt, and the Holy Ghost gonna hit them and say, come out from among them and be ye separate. Y'all better hear me. Do you hear what I'm telling you? Some of them, they gonna, the Holy Ghost gonna hit them while they trying to fornicate, and God gonna hit them and say, come out of them. I'm calling you to hire. They gonna come into church. Watch what I tell you. Watch what I tell you. Ah! He said, I still got 7,000.
church, but just wave your baby in. Wave your baby in. Come on. Wave your grandchildren in. They're coming out of homosexuality. They're coming on drugs. They're coming out of bitterness. They're coming out of hatred. One of your babies coming out the strip club. I don't even know if you know they're in there. But I just heard the Lord say, she coming out the club. I don't even know if you know they're in there. I don't know who you are. But I just heard the Lord say, somebody in here, your baby gonna stop stripping. You better praise him. Oh, thank you. Woo! My God. My God. Oh! He's anointed me to do a hard thing. Woo! I like that praise. Praise him, brother. He's so smooth. Praise him. Yeah. This is what happens when the whole house go up. Side was Pentecostal apostolic, and when the anointing would get like this, they start singing the song and say, scripture said, scripture said, scripture said, scripture said, believe on me, believe on me, believe on me, believe on me, out of your bed, 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 out of your bed. Shall flow, 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 river, 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 yes, some river, yes, some rivers, living water, living water, living water, living water. They would sing that till we start rolling in the flow, talking in tongues. The flow get ready to hit us. How many of you all believe I'm a man of God? I want to challenge you. I need everything in this house to do it. Because God's getting ready to anoint us. To do a hard thing. I like that sound. I want to hear the people. Let them praise him. Come on. Come on. Come on. That's it. Come on. Open your mouth. I like that sound. Oh. Oh, yeah. Come on. Come on, church. Come on. That's it. Come on. Somebody clap your hands and oh, yada namosh. Yada namosh. Yeah. Oh. Oh.
And it's the babies. You hear the babies? Ooh. If it were no pandemic, I would run through this house. Woo! Oh, yeah! But it ain't my hands. It's the hand of God that's anointed. You don't need my hand when you got his. Come on, lift your hands and say, do it! Oh, come on. Say it like you believe it. Lift your hands and holler. Do it, Jesus. Oh. Hit me. Jesus. I need everybody, and I know this is going to sound crazy. I need everybody who trusts God. If you can do it, to get a $100 seed in your hand. I'm pushing everybody. I need everybody here to do it. If you're online, there's several of you online that need to do it. Because God is getting ready to help you complete a hard thing. I want to hear from you. Somebody get my phone. I want to know those who go to the page. I want to know those who's sowing online. Talk to me. Bishop, I'm sowing with you. I'm sowing with you. I'm sowing with you. I'm sowing with you. Because God is getting ready to help me complete a hard thing. It's going to get easier, but it don't mean it ain't going to still be hard. It just got easier. He said, stop looking to the north, south, east, and west for man to help you. He said, I'll be your help. Don't mean that there will be no presence of men. It just means it won't be the men you expected. God said, I'll send you angels in the form of men. Bishop, I'll never forget it. I share the story often. When we bought our first building, in the Hammond location, we couldn't, we're stepping out of faith. We couldn't really, couldn't afford it. We did it. We got in there and the city told me that I couldn't have church until I got the roof done. It was not up to code. The building was kind of in just bad shape. And I sat in that room, me and my finance manager. He said, well, Bishop, what you gonna do? You told the people we moving in on Sunday. I said, I don't know. We walked around the church and there was a man who was knocking on the door. Seriously. If New Zion Temple Hammond was here, they'd tell you. And he said to us, he said, I've been trying to get a hold of you because I want to bless you. Exactly what he said. He said, what do you need? I ain't never seen this man before. And you know, I'm private and most pastors are. I'll tell you the church business. You put it in the street and hey, girl, he done bought that building, can't even get in it. And my deacon said, tell him what you need. I said, I need about $30,000. That man of God said, I'll be back. I think he wrote the check for about $25,000. I thought it was a joke. And my deacon said, well, if it go through. This is serious. I mean, because you know somebody. You know, said, if it go through, you know. I said, well, go to the bank right now. It went through. And now the next hard thing was just to find another five. I start calling around, get it. I don't care where you got to get it. Bring me $1,000. And we were marching in our church that Sunday. God, one man that I never met in my life and ain't seen him since. Ain't seen him since. I heard you. I'm next. That was 10 years ago. Help me, man. All that I need. If you just want that 100, I want you to stand all over this place. If they're online, do you get me? I want to know those online. Get your phone. Somebody let me know how to online. If they're sewing with me, tell me who's sewing. I need those online. So. God is not about whatsoever a man soweth. That's Shelly Osserine. All that I... We have a CD. I want y'all to go on iTunes and get it. It's doing really, 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 really well. God has really blessed it. Our song, the song I sung, Heal, it was at one time like 10 or something like that. Four? Praise Him. It was like four on the gospel. And it was like, it got as high as 70 on the Billboard charts for all genres. And I don't consider myself no artist. I'm not the one singing it on the CD, so y'all ain't gotta, it's somebody better than me. But go get it. It's doing really, really well. And I want y'all to get it. I think you'll be really blessed. It's called Ignite. It's just Brandon Jacobs. It's not Bishop. My title's not on there. It's just Brandon Jacobs. People are showing online. That's what I want to hear. Come on, clap for the online people, because they're with us. The rest of you who can sow 100, I want you to get 50, and I want you to stand all over this place. I'm going to sow 250. Get my wallet out. Let's see. Get that card for me. Yes. I don't know the protocol, so y'all help me. Are we just doing Cash App, Givelify? We're doing that, right? Texting, if you see it on the screen. For those of you who are watching, is it on the lower thirds? Is the information on the screen for those who are watching? Okay. Thank you so much. Get your seed and sow. I want you to lift it. While you're sowing it, I want you to just say these words. All that I need, all of my desires, God is supplying them now in the name of Jesus. The anointing of God is upon my life, for the Lord has anointed me to finish and complete a hard thing in Jesus' name. Give Him praise, because you know it's so.
God for the life of Apostle Dr. Brandon Jacobs. Come on, bless God for him. If you were blessed by that word, just jump on your feet and shout, "That was my word." Amen. Remain standing. Let me thank you for sharing with us. Those of you who are here, those of you who are online, let me thank you. Pastor Keith was showing me how you are giving online, and we just appreciate you. For number one, your presence, pushing the service in prayer. We can't all be here physically, but we are all here spiritually. And I want to thank you for your sowing and supporting this revival. And those who've come out every night, we thank God for you. Amen. Again, to all of our essential workers, will you bless God for them? We thank God for you. Amen. You, and you. Now let's look to the Lord. May the Lord bless and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you. May He turn His face toward you and give you peace. We bless you now as you leave this place and never His presence, that you find all things well in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen. Amen. Consider yourselves dismissed as they play softly. They're going to direct you out.